Good morning. We start in South Africa, where 45 people have been killed in an horrific bus crash. An 8-year-old girl is the sole survivor. She's being treated in hospital for serious injuries. Our Europe correspondent Jessica Millward has the latest.
Awful details coming out of South Africa this morning. It's believed the bus was carrying pilgrims who were travelling from Botswana to a town called Moriah for Easter services over the long weekend. The bus has plunged off that bridge you can see there, 50 metres into a ravine, and then it has caught fire, killing 45 people on board. Amazingly, the only survivor is an 8-year-old girl who has been airlifted to hospital with serious injuries. Rescue crews are at the scene trying to retrieve the remains of those people who were on the bus. The Transport Minister has also been at the scene and is vowing a full investigation, but early stages indicate that the driver of the bus, which was towing a trailer, has lost control coming round the bend of that bridge, killing 45 people on board.
AFL legend Eddie Betts has shared a confronting video of a vile racist attack outside his home. Eliza Rugg is following the story. She joins us live from Melbourne. Eliza, good morning. His children were targeted while playing basketball.
Yes, Davina, in the front yard of the family home where Eddie Betts quite rightly says they should have been safe. Now, he's posted this video. It's security vision from the house. It shows a white car driving very, very slowly out the front of the family home. Then a male driver inside that car yells out the same racist slur 4 times. It is incredibly vile, and we won't repeat it here, but it's clear it's enough to frighten those children, enough for them to stop playing. They then start running back inside the house. So it's incredibly sad and distressing to see. Now, Eddie Betts posted this video to Instagram, and within minutes, he's really been flooded with support from past and present AFL players, as well as a lot of people in the wider community as well.
I'm not shocked. I'm not shocked that it's happening. I'm more disappointed that people kind of think that this doesn't happen.
Quite simply, it just makes my blood boil. So I think everyone feels the same. I hope everyone does.
It's appalling. Australia is not a racist country, but it turns out we still have people with racist views living amongst us.
Now, in the meantime, Eddie has posted another video this morning of the kids getting out there on the basketball court, playing again this morning, saying that the incident won't stop them. He's also said he would like to speak to that man in the white car to chat to him about how this type of racist behaviour really hurts Indigenous children. Davina.
Eliza, thank you. Well, the end of the trade war on wine is being widely welcomed today after China dropped crippling tariffs on our exports to the country. We'll take you live to our Canberra and political reporter, Amanda Kopp. Amanda, good morning. It's good news, but will the industry ever recover?
Good morning, Davina. Well, at this stage, the industry says it will take years to rebuild. This all started in 2020 when China slapped taxes of more than 200% onto Australian wine exports, widely seen as a response to calls for an investigation into the origins of COVID-19. The move shut down a billion-dollar industry overnight and left winemakers scrambling. Since then, the industry has managed to diversify, sending more bottles to India and Southeast Asia, but China's reopening is a welcome boost for the industry.
It's a terrific occasion, you know, being Good Friday. It really is a great Friday for Australian winemakers.
The federal government continues to push to get rid of the remaining tariffs on other industries while balancing what can quickly become a volatile relationship.
There's more to be done. Lobster, red meat still need to be resolved, but we'll be working with the Chinese government, as we've done, to stabilise our relationship and resolve all of the outstanding impediments.
We need to maintain our sovereignty, but we also need to be able to get our product into markets. It shouldn't come at the cost of our national interest.
A fine balance to strike and a lesson this Easter not to put all your eggs in one basket.
OK, Amanda, thank you. A man has been shot dead on a street in northern Melbourne's suburb of Glenroy. Amber Johnson's at the scene as homicide police try to piece together exactly what happened.
The suburban street is teeming with detectives this morning, with the gunman still on the run. But police have reassured the public this was likely a targeted attack. It was a jogger who sounded the alarm after they heard a loud gunshot just before 5 a.m. They ran to the strip of shops in Glenroy in Melbourne's northwest to find the man's lifeless body on the road, lying next to a parked car.
I heard a bam. I thought it was like car crash. Actually, it was shot fire.
Sadly, there was a guy on the ground that passed away. It's not something that you usually see around here, so it was a very traumatising moment for me.
The street has been taped off for hours now, with the homicide squad called in to take over the investigation. Police believe the gunman fled the scene in a getaway car, with neighbours saying they heard the sound of screeching tyres shortly after the gunshot.
An 80-year-old man has died after he was hit by a car in Sydney's southwest. The man was crossing Oxley Street at Campbelltown just before midnight when the accident happened. The 26-year-old driver of the ute stopping to render assistance. Police say it's unlikely any charges will be laid. The hunt for a gunman who shot a man in Cairns is on this morning. The gun was fired after two cars collided at Edge Hill around 1 p.m. Everyone involved fled the scene. The injured man is now in police custody. He's received a non-life-threatening wound to his leg and is assisting officers with their inquiries. Two people have been taken to hospital this morning after two separate crashes on the Gold Coast. A driver was injured after a Mercedes-Benz crashed into a broken-down Dodge near the traffic lights at Southport. And in another incident, also at Southport, a hatchback rolled after colliding with a ute. A man in his 50s taken to hospital in a stable condition. The Australian Medical Association has had enough of junk food. It's now urging the federal government to impose tougher laws on unhealthy food and advertising for drinks. President Steve Robson says young children are highly susceptible to marketing ploys, and he wants restrictions across television and other media platforms from 5:30 a.m. until 11 p.m. The AMA also wants tight rules around unhealthy sponsorship of sport, arts and cultural events. It could be 2 years before there are any final answers over what exactly went wrong in the deadly Baltimore Bridge collapse. Today, part of the city paused in memory of the victims. This update from our US correspondent Jonathan Kersley.
This is a city hurting from the tragedy of this bridge collapse. Today it was a chance for sport to unite. Baseball's opening day of the season, the Baltimore Orioles at home. Fans, players, officials standing with their hands on their hearts for a moment's silence to remember the victims. The bridge itself was named after Francis Scott, the man who penned the words to the Star Spangled Banner. Today that anthem rung out. With four construction workers still unaccounted for and so much debris still in the Patapsco River, conditions have been deemed too dangerous for divers to resume recovery operations. This is now a salvage operation. Giant cranes will be used to lift the debris out of the water. The United States Navy and Army has been called up for duty to assist this major mission. And investigators say it could take up to 2 years to deliver final answers on why the cargo ship the Dali lost power and careened into the bridge. Today, the ship's pilots interviewed by investigators as more detail emerges on the final moments leading up to the tragedy, with reports after the cargo ship issued its mayday call, police already stationed near the bridge had just 90 seconds to tell those construction workers to get off the bridge and to stop other traffic coming onto it.
The Dali is almost as long as the Eiffel Tower, and the Dali has the key bridge on top of it. We're talking 3,000 to 4,000 tons of steel that's sitting on top of that ship.
And while the bridge will be rebuilt, that will take years.
Well, Christians all around the country are attending Good Friday services. Our reporter Tiffany Genders is with parishioners at St Andrew's Cathedral in Sydney. Tiff, what's been happening at the service there this morning?
Well, Davina, parishioners have been treated to a buttery hot cross bun and a nice cup of tea or coffee following this morning's service here in Sydney. Good Friday is the most solemn day on the Christian calendar, the day Jesus was crucified. So it's a day and a time to reflect on sacrifice, mercy and also hope. That message spread through song and dance here at St Andrew's Cathedral. Hundreds of people, young and old, filling the pews. news. Now, prayers were led by the Anglican Archbishop, who likened Easter to modern-day social media, saying there are similar issues of trust now, just like in the events of thousands of years ago.
Everyone knew that Jesus lived a remarkable life and was cruelly executed. But could they trust what they were being told, that he had risen from the dead? There was no live streaming, no social media influencers, but there were eyewitnesses.
We've been blessed with lovely weather here in Sydney today. Also in Melbourne, these pictures that you're seeing now from the special service at St Paul's. The faithful will return to church on Sunday for the more joyous day of Easter. Davina.
Okay, Tiff, thank you.